Okay, everyone. Hello again. So I'm going to continue with the ADAS model, all right? And actually, I have to say that we are going to have a part four of it, okay? Part four of it. It will be about the Keynesian AS. You remember this graph here, okay? Keynesian AS. And in part four, we are going to have a kind of Phillip curve, all right? The concept of Phillip curve. Now, okay, let's first continue. By the way, everyone, just a quick summary. The model that we are currently studying is called the neoclassical model, okay? Neoclassical model, neoclassical aggregate supply. And we have the short-run aggregate supply and the long-run aggregate supply. And the key concept about the short run and long run is that in short run, we have the sticky weight, okay? Sticky weight. But in long run, the weight is flexible. And remember, I always said that classical economics say that, okay, you see here, neoclassical. So classical economics believe that market will always clear. Weight flexible, market clear. So, okay, we have more than this, all right? We have more than this, but this is just a few of them. So let's continue, everyone. Now, before everything else, I have to note, I have to remark, let's say that, emphasize that in equilibrium, in the neoclassical model of aggregate demand, aggregate supply. You have two type of equilibrium. You have the short run equilibrium and the long run equilibrium. Everyone, I have, first of all, this is very important. So in this neoclassical, I have to mention again so that you remember it with me. This is classical framework, and you see that they believe that the market always clear, right? The market always clear. And in that case, we say that the short run equilibrium will be temporary. And that in the long run, the economy will move back to long run equilibrium. This sentence actually means that the market clear in long run. All right, that's the meaning. So let's look at the picture. What do we mean by short run and long run equilibrium? Everyone, this is the example of the short run equilibrium here. You see that for short run equilibrium, we have two curves. We have the short run AS and aggregate demand. When the short run AS and AD meet, you have the short run equilibrium here. But when all the three curves meet, we have the long run equilibrium here. Okay, when three lines here intersect, we have the long run equilibrium. So, I have to say that this aggregate demand ADAS model is used to analyze the fluctuation, all right? Business cycle, in other words, business cycle. And again, it can use mostly everyone. Actually, I should add something. So in this model, we say that the fluctuation can be due to shock, economic shock to aggregate demand or aggregate supply. Let's add something to this. Apart from shock, it may be due to policy change, okay? Policy change. So when the government does use fiscal policy, contraction, expansion, blah, 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 it will also cause economic fluctuation as well. Okay, it will cause economic fluctuation. So this is important. So let me highlight this. Okay, economic fluctuation are due to shock to aggregate demand or aggregate supply and the policy change, okay? Everyone, if we talk about, we have demand shock, supply shock. I forgot to mention to you, my apologies here. Everyone, the short run aggregate supply can shift to the right or left due to the economic shock. So let me maybe write this down here. So this is the example of demand shock. For demand shock is I think it's quite rare. It's about the consumer confidence. Okay, this is about the consumer confidence. The business confidence. Actually, coronavirus here is the demand shock as well. For the supply shock, we have the something like natural disaster. You have natural disaster. A flood, good weather, good or bad weather for harvest, okay? For harvest. And of course, coronavirus as well. These are economic shock. Everyone shocked unexpected even something like here as a positive AD shock, you have a more confidence, or blah blah a negative AD shock, we have coronavirus. For the AS shock, it affects aggregate supply. So you can have, for example, epidemic like what we are having now, or the bad weather, right? The bad weather, the good weather for agricultural product, natural disaster, flood. This will shift the demand and supply, okay? Depending on the type of the shock. So everyone, we are going to say that in economy, I mean neoclassical ADAS will assume, they will assume that the economy will start at the long run equilibrium. Remember, we always say that everything is perfect. Market is perfect. Market is working perfectly. Market always clear, and we will always be in full employment, right? That's what the neoclassical idea. And everyone, that's what we mean by starting at the long run equilibrium. We start at the full employment, YF, something like that. And now, when there is a shock to the AD or blah blah blah, the economy will move to the short run equilibrium. Everyone, we will move to the short run equilibrium. We will have a recessionary gap or deflationary gap and inflationary gap that we use to study. I believe that you can kind of remember this output gap from before midterm. So let me let me go to this page first. Everyone, you see here that here this is the inflationary gap. Right now you produce more than your full employment. Again, that is due to you less than UN, right? And here this is when you produce less than your full employment. So here your U is more than UN, remember. And again, everyone, this is correspond to the business cycle, actually. It's correspond to the business cycle that I used to draw to you all the time. We have a inflationary gap and recessionary gap here. So let me use this flip here, and this one is, so this is the inflationary gap, this one is the deflationary gap. All right, so they are, this is the business cycle. In case this is, we have time here, okay, time on this axis, and we have the real GDP Y there, and this is your full employment over there. So everything is linked now, you see. The good point of this model of the neoclassical is that we have the we can use it to explain the business cycle. Everyone, now, when we are here, when let's suppose that there are something happened, there are some shock, let me add something here. ADAS and economic shock or policy change. Okay, sometimes it may be due to the government change the policy, and sometimes you can move to the recessionary gap, inflationary gap. That's all possible. Okay, and everyone, to move back to the long run equilibrium, we have two ways. The first way is that the economy can slowly adjust itself to shift in the short run. As we are going to focus on this, your exam will be on this. Okay, make sure that you listen to my video and note this down. And alternatively, sometimes the government can use the policy to shift the. I mean, let's say right now we have a recessionary gap, right, due to coronavirus. What the government should do is they should use the demand side policy, blah 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 blah. Okay, everyone, let's see. So here, this is the factor that can kind of shift the aggregate demand. I think this is something that we cover in the previous slide. So when you have a change in autonomous consumption or investment, or also you can have a fiscal policy and monetary policy, or can affect the aggregate demand. Your AD will be consist of C plus I plus T. Remember, AE and AD are the same. Although we derive the AD from the ISLM, but actually the thing is that they are all linked with this, the aggregate expenditure function that we studied before. So everyone, when you have a fiscal policy or monetary policy, they are going to affect your AD and will shift your AD, right? Okay, here I just note that since GT and M can be perfectly controlled, this is government spending tax and the money supply, okay, the money supply can be perfectly controlled by the government, they are not economic shock. These three things here are the policy chain that I mentioned here, that I mentioned earlier. Sometimes you can have a policy change that affect the ADAS that can cause the business cycle, that can cause an output gap like this. So of course they are not going to be called economic shock because this is something that the government planned. All right, okay, so AD shock, even that chain CNI or blah blah blah, this one you can read this, it's very simple. So let's suppose that when you have a positive AD shock, you can see that let's suppose that we have this business cycle. Okay, everyone remember that in this model we will say that we assume to be in the long run equilibrium. Okay, we assume to be in the long run equilibrium. And now suppose that we have the positive aggregate demand shock. For example, you have a higher consumer confidence. Your demand will shift to the right. And what happened is that it will be like this, right? It will be like inflationary gap here at this point. You see, at this blue point, we have a short run equilibrium, and now we have an inflationary gap here. Remember, this is AD, this is short run AS, this is long run AS, price and Y. this is why and time. Anyway, what we can do here is that we can, to correct this inflationary gap, the government can use the contractionary fiscal policy or monetary policy, and then we can kind of shift this aggregate demand back to this original position. Okay, that's what we can do one way. But I'm not going to test you this this approach here. I won't ask you, okay? It's too easy. And again, this is for your future course, right? When you study in your second year, you will have to kind of understand this adjustment process that I'm going to teach you next. So again, let me just, in the first case, we can simply shift the AD back to this position. We can use the policy to stabilize the economy. You remember, we want to try to stabilize the economy, and we can use the policy to do that. And alternatively, okay, maybe I should draw another line to make it kind of more realistic. So you want to slow down economy, right? So you kind of shift there. So this is AD3, for example. This is AD2 and this is AD1. That's one way that you can solve the output gap. That's one way that you can correct this inflationary gap. Now, there's another way. I told you here, right? I told you that to move back to the long run equilibrium, you have two ways. One is that you can use the government, government can intervene using the demand side policy to shift the AD. And here, this is where things get serious. We want to see how can the economy correct itself. Remember, this is neoclassical. Neoclassical, everyone. Neoclassical is about self-correcting market. Let me write this down. Neoclassical means that market is self-correcting. So you will always kind of return to the long run equilibrium. So you see, everyone, let's go to this slowly and please listen carefully. Everyone, let's say that we start at this point here. You have three lines together. Okay, you have three lines together. AD1, short run AS, long run AS, we start at this point here. Now let's say that we have a positive aggregate demand shock. So when you have a positive demand shock, your demand increase, right? We have an inflationary gap here. Let's write this down as well. Okay, so let's say that at 2, y greater than yf, inflationary gap, u less than un. But then everyone, you can see that from 2, we are going to move to 0.3. How and why? Why is this happening? Everyone, the reason is simple. At 0.2, you are going to have inflation. So you should add here as well. So you have three things here, right? You have you also have inflation as well. So at 0.2, we have three things. We have a inflationary gap. Your U is lower than your natural rate. You have inflation. Everyone, the cost of living is expensive. Because of the demand shock, the cost of living goes up. Everyone, in the short run, the wage will be fixed, right? In the short run, the wage will be fixed. But in the long run, the wage can be flexible. So what happened is that when you have inflation here, when you have inflation here, again, maybe you can change this into price level, okay? Let me use P. It's the same thing, it's not that different. So we have P1, P2, and P3. So at P1, Sorry. At P2 here, you have inflation. The price level increased. What happened is that the in the long run, everyone, in the long run, the worker will ask for more wage. Okay, because you have inflation, and now the wage is sticky, right? In the short run, the wage is sticky, but in the long run, they can ask for higher wage. So when they ask for higher wage, the firm has higher cost of production. The firm face higher cost of production. So what happened is that the firm will supply less. So from point two here, the short run AS shift to the left, and then we kind of move back to the long run equilibrium. Oh, okay, I wrote everything here. So this is when your economy slowly adjusts itself. So when you have higher price level, it means that cost of production increase. As I told you, the wage can also go up because the worker will ask for higher wage. And this will shift the short run AS to the left, and then we will return to the long run equilibrium. I'm going to explain the whole thing again so that we all together. If you think you are fine, you can fast forward, okay? Let's first say that we are all in the long run equilibrium here. We are in this long run equilibrium. And now suppose that we have a, let me check a little bit. Even now I'm going to talk about the opposite direction. Let's see, we are going to talk about the opposite direction. Oh, maybe I should talk with the I guess I'm going to talk with the positive AD shock. Okay, and I let you think as a homework when you have a negative AD shock. Everyone, now let's start. First, suppose that we have a more confidence. Now let's say that the economy is looking good, everything is working perfectly. Let's say that we solve coronavirus, for example. We solve coronavirus and everyone in the world is happy. And now confidence returned. Everyone has become optimistic. Confidence returned. So now we have a shift in aggregate demand curve, right? Your AD shift to this point. Everyone, let me show you something. So this is when your P price level is P1, okay? Everyone, in this long run equilibrium, your wage and price are consistent, okay? Your wage and price are consistent. I'm going to say that P1 and W1 are consistent. So this wage here match the cost of living, okay? W1 and P1, they match the cost of living. Now we have a higher confidence. You see that your price will have to kind of go up, right? Your price will go up. So from P1 to P2. However, everyone, your wage is still stuck at W1. You see? Because we have a sticky wage there, right? We have a sticky wage in the short run. So the wage will fix here, but everyone, the price will go up because of higher demand, right? Price will rise because of higher demand, and that's why the firm will supply more in the short run. The firm will supply more in the short run, you see, and that's why your output increase here to this Y here, which is more than YF. Everyone, this is where this is point two. Let's say that this is point one, right? And this is point two. Point one will be here. Point two will be here, everyone. Point two will be here. This is your inflationary gap. And you can see from the business cycle that we will eventually return to this full kind of trend line, or the YF in this case. Remember, this is YF, right? So we are going to return to this point here. And the reason is very simple. You can see here now we have a higher cost of living, but the wage is still cheap. You see, the wedge is still shaped. We have a sticky wedge there. So what will happen is that in the long run, as the economy, as time pass, as we move from short run to long run, your short run AS will shift to the left because the wedge will go up, everyone. The wedge will go up. And if you can recall that, you can recall that, let's see here. Following event would shift short run AS to the right and exogenous decrease in wedge rate. But in this case, it's increased, right? So when wedge increase, your short run AS will shift to the left. It's the opposite, all right? It's the opposite. So what happened is that at two, wedge and price are not consistent. Please write more than this, okay? This is just a quick note. You should say that, oh, the wedge is still cheap, but the cost of living is high, right? The cost of living, so they are not consistent. So as time pass, WNP adjust and consistent. I will use the word consistent. They are not equal, everyone. The price and weight are not equal, but they are going to adjust and they will reach the point, for example, P3. This is P3, right? And your W will be W3. I'm not going to write W2, okay? Because W2 will be here at maybe at this point here. If your W2 is W2, the output will be there. You see, the output will be there. But right now, your wage is 1, right? And so that's why the firm produce more, because it's cheaper. The real wage is lower. It's cheaper, so you produce more. But then as time pass, they will eventually adjust, and then we will reach this kind of long run full employment here. And that's where your W3 consistent with P3. You see that we will eventually return to this point here. This point here. Chip, then chip. That's the adjustment process. This is how you explain the business cycle, okay? So everything is the economy will adjust because of the wage and price flexible. You see, wage and price flexible, and the economy will adjust, and we will reach the full employment. That's the logic. So in the case of the opposite case, try to think this at home, okay? So in the opposite case now, in this case, you see that the worker will ask for higher wage, right? The cost of living go up. The worker will say, oh, boss, I need more wage. Otherwise, I can't live. So that's what happened. However, in the opposite direction, this is the opposite direction. The firm will say that, oh, Mr. Sam, I am your boss, right? But I have to ask you to cut your wage because otherwise I'm going to go bankrupt. So please, Mr. Sam, please lower your wage. That's what will happen in the opposite case. Okay, and then we will kind of return to the full employment level. So try this at home, okay, as your homework. Now, everyone, that's the aggregate demand shock, okay? Positive demand shock. Now we have the, alternatively, we have a supply shock as well. I told you, right, about the oil price shock. We have an oil price shock in 1970. Everyone, this is when Mr. Ken, Keynesian economic, got criticized. Because of the oil price shock, Keynesian economy kind of failed. So, and they, we have more and more new branch of economic coming up. So this is when you have a stagflation during this time. If you want to read more, you can search Wikipedia, this word, stagflation. 1970 stagflation. I'm going to go through that afterwards. Everyone, the supply shock is very difficult and it's very complicated, very hard to solve with this problem as well. When we have a stagflation, that's why, it takes long time to solve this problem. You know, during this time, this is just a story, okay? So we have a OPEC country, you know, OPEC. OPEC is the oil exporting country. Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Iran, and Kuwait, whatever. This guy, Arabian country, they export oil. And they kind of collude, you know, collude. Collude mean they act as one. They work together. They work together. There are many countries. They work together and set a high. They cut the oil production. You see, they cut the oil production. And what happened is that the oil price rise. The oil price, right? And we call, we have a stagflation during that period. I'm going to explain after this. So let's first go through this stuff first. In the case of supply shock, we can have a permanent shock or temporary shock. For example, you have a permanent change in the birth rate or mortality rate. You can have a permanent shock. This is long run shock, right? Long run shock. But in the case of temporary shock, you can have something like the epidemic, or maybe a good or bad weather. But you know, in the case of coronavirus, in my opinion, it may be this one. It's you see, because many people have died. Many people have died from coronavirus. And I think it lasts for some time. So one can argue that it is permanent shock. It depends on your reasoning. I don't mind if you want to say that it's the temporary shock. That's fine. In Thailand, it's maybe temporary. But in the US, I think you could say that it's the permanent shock. Now let's see what we have when you have a permanent shock. You see that you are long run. I mean, when you have a permanent shock, what happened is that the long run AS together with the short run AS will kind of shift together to the left, and we will be at this point three here. Everyone, this point three here is very, very bad. You see, very, very bad. Look why it's so bad. First of all, you have unemployment. You see, you have unemployment, and also you have inflation as well. Okay, so negative supply shock cause what we call stagflation that I just told you. Everyone, stagflation is like this. This is a stagflation. So I'm going to, let's say that your short run supply curve shift here. What happened is that we are going to have a higher, you see, let me write down first. Stagflation is when you have inflation plus unemployment. This is what we mean by stagflation. Usually it's due to a shift in the short run AS. Okay, so here you have a stagflation. You see that the output fall means that you have a Y fall. It means that your U will rise. Also, this means that when price increase, it means that you have an inflation. Okay. This one is mean that you have a inflation. So right now, in during this time period, we have a stagflation, right? You see that it's very bad because People don't have job. People did not have job, and at the same time, the goods are very expensive. You see, the goods are very expensive, and people don't have job. That's the worst of the worst. But in this case, you see that this is the term. You could say that this is the when you have a short term shock. So my short run AS only shift, right? But here in this case, we have a long run AS shift. In this case, it's we don't have an output gap, right? Because we move there. I mean, the whole economy moved there, which is not good, of course, because it's like you see that your potential output falls. Okay, everything is bad. So in this case, because it's the permanent shock. In the case of stagflation, what about the temporary shock here? Let's talk. Sorry if I kind of swap my screen. So everyone, for the permanent shock, you see that what happened is we have a permanent change in YF. Okay, permanent change in YF, your full employment change. But again, it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing because right now we have less output for whole country, right? We are not good. It's like your PPF kind of shrink, your PPF shrink in one, which is not a good thing, of course. But now, what about the temporary shock here? So in the case of temporary shock, I think it's very simple. So what happened is that, let's think about the weather. Everyone, when you have a bad weather, bad harvest, it only lasts 1 year, right? So when you have a bad weather, your supply shift for 1 year, but then after that it's returned to normal. Everything returned to normal after a year. And so it's not that serious when you have a bad weather, right? But sometimes, of course, it may be last long, and of course it's not a good thing. Again, you have a stagflation. This is the stagflation that I told you. Okay. So now we are going, let's see. Okay, that's all the three, right? So everyone, in the case of the, let's talk, we can use this ADAS model to show inflation as well right now, because in the ADS model is about price level, and it can be used to show the inflation, right? Inflation is the change in price level. Okay, in case you may already forgot, change in price level, that's what we mean by inflation. So we can use the this ADS model to show you two type of inflation. We have a demand pull inflation. Demand pull inflation. This is when you have for example, let me write down here. You can have a government policy, right? For example, government use expansionary fiscal policy. It can cause demand pull. Or you can have a AD shock. That's fine. Positive shock, okay? Positive shock. So in that case, it can create demand pull inflation. You can see on this diagram that you have a higher price here. You have inflation over here, but of course you have more work. That's not a bad thing. It's fine. You have job to do, and the price level go up. It's not that bad. But here, this is the worst case. You have this is when you have a stagflation, everyone. This is the cost push inflation will cause stagflation, all right? Cause stagflation. And once again, everyone, stagflation is when you have both inflation, this is inflation, and unemployment as well. Okay? You have inflation and unemployment. So, okay, so I guess this is just a quick summary. You can see that the when you have a shift in aggregate demand, will only affect the output in the short run. Everyone, remember, when you have an increase in AD like this, your AD shift, right? You have a output increase in the short run, but not in the long run. We will return to our equilibrium eventually. That's the key idea. I should have mentioned this. P will change, okay. Price level will change. I did not write it clearly there. So when you have a shift in AD, the output will not change in the long run, but the price level will change. On the other hand, the temporary AS shock, of course, it does not affect the long run at all here. Think about the weather, as I told you. It will only last for 1 year, and everything will be fine after that. But in the case of permanent shock, then of course it will affect long run and short run. Everyone, now this is the key conclusion here. This is the key, as I always mention you about the classical. Actually, I should write here that this is the neoclassical ADAS model summary. So the long the economy will has a self-correcting mechanism. What do we mean by self-correcting mechanism? It means the flexible wage. This is the self-correcting mechanism, the flexible wage, and then we will return to the long run equilibrium due to this flexible wage in the long run. Although everyone, we can use the government, I mean government can use policy to speed up the adjustment process. Okay, I guess that will be all. Again, we will continue on the part 4, okay? Thank you everyone.